Abraham Maslow. We're talking about the humanistic psychologist, as we were talking about before. We have already covered Carl Rogers and his client-centered therapy. When we get into abnormal psychology and talk about the disorders that people might encounter in their life and how to go about therapy, you'll see Carl Rogers again, because the humanistic movement changed things. Again, it was a reaction against psychoanalytic points of view and behavioristic points of view, and it held that you have this ability as a human being to grow, to change, that you have an inner directedness, that you have a uniqueness and free will. So look at Abraham Maslow. He developed this hierarchy of needs. And you might say, well, when would I ever use that kind of stuff? I've seen this hierarchy of needs used in business. I've seen it used in sports. It's a pretty handy concept. It's an idea that helps understand human needs. So he has it labeled in a hierarchy where some needs take precedence over other needs, where his overall point is that you have the ability to grow. Not only do you have the ability, you're compelled to grow. You have to grow unless something gets in your way. You have to be all you can be unless circumstances limit you. So if you look at an acorn, for example, right? If an acorn falls into fertile ground, gets buried at the right time, has enough sunlight, has enough rain, has enough space, it has no choice, right, but to become a massive tree. Assuming its genetics will allow it, it has no choice but to do that. So in other words, it has to grow. It has to develop. But life ain't always like that, right? That acorn might fall near a squirrel, and that's the end of that acorn, right? Or it might fall into ground that's not nutrient-rich. It might not have enough water. It may not have enough light. It may get various amounts of that. It may be too many trees in the area crowded in. Right? All kinds of circumstances might arise to prevent that acorn from becoming the tree it was destined to be. That's the same idea here. There's a lot of circumstances and obstacles in your life that prevent you from reaching your full potential, but where the psychodynamic and behavioral schools of thought thought, well, you know, that's just what it is, and you're kind of limited to who you are. The humanist thought, you can get around that. If you can understand your circumstances and better understand yourself, you can change your circumstances. And as such, you'll have no choice but to go higher and higher up this pyramid of needs. So at the bottom, we got physiological needs. You have to have these met. These are survival needs. These are primary reinforcers when we look at to behaviorism, right? You got to have food. You've got to have shelter from the elements. But beyond that, the next level up is safety. If you've got food and shelter, that doesn't mean you're necessarily safe, right? So safety would be protecting yourself against hostile forces from the world. Might be your neighbors. It might be your government, right? It might be an enemy of the state of some type. But we lock our doors if we have doors to lock, if you see what I'm saying. If you're homeless, you have no doors to lock, right? You have no place to go. So what are you worried about? Eating first. Second to that, you find a place to stay, where you feel some security. If this is met, then you can really move into love and belongingness, where you have feelings for other people and they reciprocate and return those to you, where you feel part of a family or part of a community, part of an intimate relationship. In that sense, you have a different level of fulfillment of your needs. Once these are filled, then you feel good. You have now reached self-esteem needs, feeling good about yourself because you have what you need to live. You have a place that you feel comfortable and safe. You have people that love you and you love them. Naturally, it follows that you start to work on feeling the best you can about yourself. Esteem needs now need to be met. And then once you're feeling as good as you can possibly feel about yourself and you've got security all down through that pyramid, you move into this top pinnacle part called self-actualization, where you become all you can be. You realize your full potential. You exercise what has been latent but has been yearning to be part of yourself, because it is part of yourself. It's part that's been hidden by circumstances that have prevented you from being the person you could be. But once you've got all these obstacles removed, you can't help but be the person that you were meant to be. In fact, before he died, Maslow actually went a step further and blew the top off the pyramid and said, once you've finished all of these things, you're not satisfied. It's not fulfilling anymore to be all you can be. Now you have to turn outward to get your fulfillment. Now you have to give back. Now you might give back in any of these stages. One of the critiques of any stage theory is that you may be in multiple places simultaneously, right? Just because you lose your job doesn't mean your family doesn't love you anymore. But believe me, if you lose your job, you don't start reading philosophy. You start reading want ads, right? You start readjusting your life based on the primary needs. As they're satisfied, you move up or down this hierarchy. But once you're fully satisfied, you take kind of these pinnacle people that we look to, JFK, Martin Luther King Jr., Gandhi, Mother Teresa. What did they do with their lives once they'd satisfied all their personal needs? They then went to trying to satisfy social needs. It wasn't satisfying just to be the best they could be. They had to go further and do more to help others. They moved up past self-actualization. That inner-directed need to fulfill one's potential, though, from Maslow's point of view, is something most people never achieve. They don't reach it. If they do, they have these things called peak experiences, which aren't on your test, but clearly are on your slide. The idea that you have these little epiphanies, these little revelations, these little moments of clarity where you see yourself connected to the greater world or the greater community in a way that really is life-changing potentially, but they come and they go. People have a peak experience and then it leaves, and then they're back into life, right? But when everything's going really, really well with your life, you have these inklings of what you might do with it, these special things, right? You reach for your ideal self. If we look at Carl Rogers' terminology, right? You reach to be the best you can be, knowing you can't ever be perfect. Now, we're going to move from the humanistic and the psychodynamic and the behavioral into a thing called trait theory.